Hello, hello, are we live? It just cuts in with freaking Sweden, seriously? Wow. Okay, so obviously, you know, I usually have, you know, the random non-gaming background soundtrack, which includes, you know, Minecraft soundtrack and C4A music. This should be behind me, not in front of me, get out of here. You know, as well as other ambient pieces. But I thought it'd be cool to actually have some Kevin Kleiner music for the intro. So if you want to check out the song I was just playing, it was Meet the Bad Batch from... It was actually from Clone Wars Season 7 and not the Bad Batch itself, because that's where they were introduced. But yeah, the link's in the description, it's updated. Might have to refresh, but welcome everybody to Debate Director 52. Why is chat not showing? I pasted the QOTD into chat. And now chat is literally just non-existent on my screen. Let me refresh this. Sorry, guys. Give me a second. But how are we doing? I can see Livy in chat. Excuse me. I can see Platy in chat. I'm doing my first YouTube stream in 2 years on my channel after the stream. If you wanted to join, Matt, that'd be cool, Platy. What are you streaming? I'm doing another stream in 140 minutes from now. I should really do this notification now. I'm doing sister location in a bit. But I could probably watch that in between. I don't know. That'd be cool. What are you streaming? And welcome, fellas. I'm just gonna do this now, honestly, because I'm doing sister location with Lucy. It's a collab. I've been planning this for a while. We're doing this in a bit, so I'm gonna just pop that on there right now. I'll do Instagram later. Not as many people use that anyway. So, fellas, this music's really like random, but yeah. No, the volume wasn't up yet. Tell me if the audio balance is okay, guys. If, you know, it needs changing, needs tweaking. I don't know if the, you know, the music's too loud or my voice is too loud. You know, one or the other. Alright, Platy, that makes sense. So anyways, fellas. Bad Batch. The Bad Batch, the spiritual successor to the Clone Wars, an exciting newish, animated Star Wars TV show. I enjoyed it, but how does it really rank? Which episodes of the first season were best and worst, and why? Join me as I review each one of the 16 episodes. So, I'm going solo today, guys. No one wanted to join for the collab, but I know it's not really new. It's not, like, fresh. But they did come out this year, and I just haven't really had a chance to do this until now. Because I've just had other things in the way. I don't know. I'm sure, theoretically, I could have done this sooner, but it would have been at the expense of something else. So, yeah. Yeah. Cool, Libby. Thank you. The Bad Batch, guys. It's just Bad Batch, actually. There's no the. So I should probably get rid of that. We're doing a tier list. The link's in the description if you want to have a go at this for yourself. But today, I want to delve into this show and just rank each episode. We're going to be judging it. The criteria that we're going to be judging it by is plot development and character development. The two most important things in any form of... media? I would say literature, but this isn't written. It's a TV show. It's animation. Hey DJ, thank you for joining too. And yeah, because the thing is, guys, this whole show is really good in terms of animation quality. It is astounding. It's really crisp, really clean. You know, very detailed. You know, the soundtrack is consistent with all before. It's fantastic. You know, yeah, all the technical stuff is stellar. I just really want to rate each episode of this season because I really enjoyed this. And as a big Clone Wars fan, you know, seeing this and seeing the Bad Batch return in this way, I don't know, it's pretty interesting. Now, I should mention, obviously, there will be spoilers. I mean, there are already spoilers on this screen, but like, guys, I'm saying this because I don't know... I don't think many of you here watch the show, and it's been a while, but just in case, obviously there's going to be loads of spoilers for Season 7 of the Clone Wars, as well as Bad Batch. I mean, there's been plenty, so I shouldn't need to do a spoiler warning for that now, but yeah. I'm just going to do a ranking, basically, of each episode, and I've got them here in the order they released. The first 16 episodes of Season 1, there is a confirmed Season 2, second season, and yeah. Music's a bit loud for me. Tell me if it's too loud for you. It looks like it's okay, but yeah. We're just going to get into this. I'm not going to waste any time, so... I was trying to get onto Disney Plus, but it wouldn't let me log in. I better actually not show this on stream. Sorry. Let me just try and log into Disney Plus again, because I actually want to look at the list. Oh, here we go. It's actually working this time. I think it's because I input the wrong password too many times. I was really stupid. Hold on a second. Where's the password? I have it written down somewhere. Here it is. That's it, right? No? Wait, hold on. Oh, there we go. We got it. Alright, cool. So, boys, let me show off what I wanted to show off. And, here we are. I don't think this is exposing any private info. This is just my... Well, it's not actually, my Disney Plus. It's my brother's, and he shared it with a bunch of people. He's very generous like that. So, what we've got here is all the Bad Batch episodes, okay? So, if you haven't seen the show, go watch it. Come back to the stream after you've seen it. I'm gonna be spoiling everything. So, there's 16 episodes, season 2 is confirmed, and a lot happens in this season, or maybe not a lot. I just want to look at each episode individually, although I've heard it's very good to kind of watch them and binge watch them together, because they flow really nicely, and I did do that. I did a binge session a few months ago, when I was planning the stream. I binged all the episodes in one day, and I was like, yeah, this is an improved experience. So yeah, I'm going to stop wasting time. We've already gone through 2 songs, and I'm, 10 minutes in now? 8 minutes? 9 minutes? Yeah. So, let's do this. So, episode 1, Aftermath. Now, Aftermath is the premiere. It was 75 minutes rather than the usual 20 to 30. It was a lot longer. And this one deals, you know, immediately with Order 66, the end of the Clone Wars, what happens to the Bad Batch, and where they were during Revenge of the Sith. And it's really interesting. We actually get to see them return to Kamino. We get to see them, you know, engaging with the regs. we also get to see the conflicts and the tension beginning to mount between Crosshair and Hunter, especially. And the introduction of Omega. So there's a lot of cool stuff happening. But it's not disjointed in any way. It follows quite a logical sequence. The pacing's pretty nice. You know, we get to see Tarkin come back. That was a nice feature. Again, there's a lot of fan service in this kind of thing, I will admit, but it was well placed because it makes sense for him to be there at that time. You get to see the Republic change to the Empire, have these guys really tested, and all the, like, inhibitor chip stuff. I'm kind of surprised that Echo's inhibitor chip didn't work because it was, like, removed away with the, like, separatist experimentation, but I guess it makes sense now. It's really interesting how they played it out. And yeah, just trying to think back to all the scenes, really. In terms of character development, it's massive because it sets up the entire show. Yeah, and obviously plot development as well because it sets up the entire show. You know, we get to see the Bad Batch, you know, gradually, you know, realize, in fact, suddenly realize, really, after some, like, tensions, on that mission to assassinate Saw Gerrera and, you know, his rebels, that actually, you know, this isn't, you know, what they were made for. These guys aren't separatists, they're civilians. And then they get arrested, and then, you know, they amplify Crosshair's chip, and Crosshair is the only one whose inhibitor chip is somewhat working, and they amplify it, and then Crosshair is obviously, you know, working for the Empire, whereas the rest of them are not. So the Bad Batch are forced to flee. Crosshair actually shoots Wrecker. He doesn't die, of course, but, you know, he gets injured. And, yeah, they take Omega with them. Now, I know Omega wasn't popular at first. I was expecting everyone to be annoyed with her. Like, I thought, well, she's a child. But actually, I warmed to her character quite quickly, and I think most of us did as well. So it was good to see. In this episode, she's still kind of, like, a bit of a mystery. But it was an interesting mystery. And it was nice to have, you know, a character that wasn't voiced by Dee Bradley Baker for a bit of diversity. I think it was nice to have a child as well, because that's really important for the next episode. I think I have to give Aftermath probably an A rank. There was a lot riding on it. It had a bigger response. In fact, maybe an S rank. I'm not sure. You know, it pretty much sets up the whole series. You know, we get to see Order 66. The Kanan Easter egg was weird. The reference at the start, because that conflicts like an existing comic. So I could probably mark it down for that. But everything else, like the training sequences, I'm thinking, you know, I just love seeing Kamino. The Kamino aesthetic's really cool. And just seeing their whole dynamic. Saw Gerrera's all, like, the tie-ins with other media are really cool, like Rebels and whatnot, but also just the story of the Bad Batch. I'm gonna give it an A rank because, nah, I'm giving it an S rank. It's a bit flawed, but I think I've got to give Aftermath an S rank. This episode absolutely slapped, and I'm spending more time in it because it was a bigger episode. Like, I'm really trying to think now. I don't want to go in and skip through because, you know, Disney Plus has this thing where if you try and take a screenshot, it just blacks out. Like, you can't share it. If I try and stream this, will it just black out the screen? I'm really curious. Is that visible on the stream? Like, does that just black out? Or am I able to stream it? Because I feel like I shouldn't be able to. No! So, like, I don't know how, but it detects that there's recording software. So, wait, can I skip through this on stream without violating copyright? If I mute it, just in case. If I mute it, I can actually skip through the episode. You guys won't be able to see anything because of Disney's, Disney has, like, copyright, like, protection. I don't know what it is. You can see the preview down here, I think. But you can't actually see what's on screen. So, that's actually pretty helpful. But, yeah, oh, I'm remembering in more detail now. It's been a while, guys. I should have rewatched it closer to the time, but I couldn't time properly. There were some nice references at the start to the Clone Wars, and it's like their introduction was really bombastic. The tone change and pacing and dialogue was just really cool. You know, I like seeing how the group kind of reacts to everything and responds and bounces off each other. And Omega's just kind of introduced here, but she still plays like a decent role. And it's like, they don't thrust her into being the spotlight because that wouldn't be good pacing. Yeah, honestly, I think I have to give this an S rank. The ending as well was really good. That aftermath is an S rank. But yeah, Disney planned ahead. So, Disney, I know we all chat shit about Disney sometimes, and, you know, fair enough, but nice work. I can actually stream Bad Batch without spoiling it now. This is fantastic. I can, like, show it off on screen. It doesn't matter because it's automatically blocked. So, like, it's an automatic, like, copyright defense. I've muted it in case, though, because it might, I don't know if that would, you know, affect it.
Hello?
Joe, hi, can I help you?
I just kept saying I'm back from
Brian. Right, okay.
How are you doing?
I'm vibing.
Nice. You doing the live stream?
Yeah.
Oh, Brian. Hi, guys. It's okay. I'm gonna go.
Enjoy. You have a good time now.
Yeah, you too, bro.
Get a load of this guy. Went to Brighton. What a prankster gangster. Oh, man. Anyway. But yeah, they did plan ahead. They did plan ahead. So anyway, guys, feel free to do your own review. Has anyone here actually watched Bad Batch? Because, like, I have no idea who has and hasn't. But yeah, so the next episode is Cut and Run. Now, Cut and Run is pretty cool. Cut and Run is probably also an S rank, without any doubt in my mind. I think Cut and Run has to be an S rank because it is massive development of the plot and the characters. But there's also loads of other cool stuff it does. You know, as a Star Wars fan, like the world building and the tie-ins and the kind of like logic of everything. I like that they explain that because then it's like there's small details which kind of line up with, you know, Rebels and Rogue One and the main movies. And like it kind of just explains the logic of things. Without, you know, detracting, you know, from the main storyline. And if I skip through here again, I know you guys can't see it, but this episode was really about Omega. It was really about giving Omega some time to, you know, get to know the Bad Batch. And also, you know, develop her character massively. Because she has been she's been, you know, contained on Kamino all her life. You know, all she's known is the cloning facility. And now, you know, she's got, like, you know, a bunch of space dads, you know, like, you know, Hunter's her space dad. But Hunter doesn't know how to be a dad. All Hunter knows is being a soldier. That's all any of them know. So, like, they both have this dynamic of trying to, like, learn to live with each other and kind of, like, you know, like, Hunter has to learn, like, how to, like, act around a child. This is not something any of them were ever prepared for. And Omega has to kind of, like, you know, work out her kind of, like, you know, issues as well as someone who's just completely inexperienced, really. And, you know, there's just some great, like, conflict. And the brilliant thing, the most brilliant thing about this is the return of Cut Laquane. Like, I would never have expected them to bring him back, but it was such a great decision because it perfectly fits into the narrative because Cut is not only another clone who defected early on the Clone Wars and who Rex met, and we also get a name drop of Rex, which is just a lot of great stuff. But the thing is, Cut is a clone, just like Hunter, so they've got a lot in common, but he's also a father. He knows how to be a dad, he knows how to be a family person, he knows how to be more than a soldier and more of a rounded human being rather than just an organic droid. And, you know, the Bad Batch are already genetically modified, so they're very much not organic droids already. They're very individually unique compared to most clones who, I would say, actually have a lot of personality as well. But it's in this episode that he really works out with Omega, you know, how he needs to change, what he needs to do, and he gradually improves over the season. And it's like, he decides at first that, no, Omega, you're not going to have a good life with a bunch of runaway, you know, soldiers. Like, this is not a safe life for a kid, alright? This is not a good life for a kid. But then, you know, she insists that she wants to stay with them because, you know, and again, not all of this is revealed yet, but, you know, they're her brothers. She is a clone. In fact, she is their older sister. And that's explained later in the season. But, like, what's more important is that, just, you know, they are all she has. And although she had a good time with, you know, Cut's family, like, they are her family. And that's how she sees them. So they decide that they're going to make do and they're going to change to make life better. It's just a really wholesome arc on both ends, because Omega realizes a bit, you know, like, what she needs to do, you know, in order to fit in. Like, you know, there's this running gag throughout the series of, like, tech trying to teach her, you know, how to fly and, like, all the technical stuff and, like, about the ship and stuff before she's allowed to, like, fly it, which comes up later. Again, it's all connected, it's great. But, you know, there's also, like, this whole dynamic with Hunter that, you know, he's got to learn to be, like, a father. And all the other characters get their great moments as well. It's not just those two. Tech and Echo have this great banter. Echo was one of the most underutilized characters in this season, sadly, but, like, he gets some good use, and Wrecker is just, he's just funny, man. Like, Wrecker's just being Wrecker in this episode, and that's all you need. Obviously, different characters get their spotlights in different episodes, kind of, mostly. But yeah, we also learn about, you know, the, port codes, the kind of, the way the Empire is now controlling the galaxy by numbering every citizen, basically, so that they can have complete surveillance, like, you know, government surveillance over every citizen in the galaxy, ideally. And it's like, you know, chain codes, that was it. It's like they have to get chain codes to leave the planet, and there's like a good plot there. S rank, absolutely an S rank. Now, episode 3, replacements. Honestly, there's a whole bunch of early series episodes which are pretty forgettable because they all kind of run into each other and they're all a bit samey. But replacements, honestly, I don't want to be that guy. But I think this one also deserves an S rank. I just really like this TV show, okay? Alright, let me bring them all down to A, and let's just really think about this critically, okay? Because I know I'm being very generous right now. But the thing about this episode is that it's fantastic. It is, it's just fantastic, because there's so much going on that furthers the plot and furthers the characters. And that is all you need. First of all, there's a hint at the start with Tech. He's, like, trying to find a device that can find out what's going on with the chips in their brains, because they don't really know about that yet. They've only kind of got a vague idea about the inhibitor chips. So it's like there's a stem of that. You know, Wrecker has a headache, which is, of course, you know, another bit of foreshadowing about, you know, the inhibitor chips. And there's all kinds of little details which they put in the great moments. There's also this great dynamic with Wrecker and Omega, Wrecker being, like, the older brother. Like, he has a headache, so he stays in. And then he makes the, like, back-like cockpit area, like, a nice, like, bedroom for Omega. So, like, because, like, you know, at first, like, he, like, Omega's, like, offering him the extra food because he's still hungry, and then Hunter's like, hey, listen, she's just a kid, right? And then Wrecker's like, oh, I'm sorry. And it's just like there's this great character, because he starts off completely insensitive to the needs of a child, because they're hardened soldiers, you know. They, even though the Wrecker is a bit of a big child, you know, they don't know quite how to act around a child or treat a child. So what ends up happening is that he gives rather than takes by the end of the episode. It's a great little arc for Wrecker in this episode, you know. Echo is sadly underutilized. He is kind of like the banter duo with Tech, which could be worse, you know. There's this moment at the start where Wrecker's like, we're not gonna die, and he has to, like, not act scared around Omega to comfort. It's just the greatest. But Omega's not this, like, defenseless little brat at all. Like, at this point, she's still, you know, not the hero she's gonna be later on. But, well, this episode's really interesting because we actually get to see what's going with Crosshair, and I'll come back to that. But, like, in this episode, we get to see Omega really take initiative and actually, you know, lead. Because what happens is that they crash land on a moon. It's a very simple, generic premise, but it's perfect for early in the season character development. And basically, there are monsters on the moon that steal parts they need to repair the ship. And what happens is that, one of them steals the, like, one of them, like, takes off Hunter's oxygen mask, because it's, like, a moon, there's a very thin atmosphere, and he's basically knocked out, because he goes on without it for a few seconds. Omega saves him, she puts it back on, and then she also manages to work out, on her own, taking Hunter's gun and the flashlight, that the beast is attracted to energy. So instead of shooting it, she finds the peaceful solution, throws the flashlight, and gets the, like, fuse box or whatever it was back, and distracts the monster that's, like, feeding on, like, electronic energy. And it's like, not only does she take the initiative, she saves Hunter's life, she, you know, doesn't resort to violence, she finds a peaceful solution, and she completes the mission all on her own. And she's like, Technically, the others have accelerated aging, so they're like maybe 5 to 10, even though they appeared like 20 to like 30 or whatever. But Omega has normal aging. She's like Boba's age. She's about 13 or 14, and it's like she doesn't have military training like the others. So the resourcefulness is incredible, and it's just a really good episode for character building for Omega, because unlike certain other female protagonists in new Star Wars media, she's not a Mary Sue. You know, she has to, like, you know, work for her achievements, and we gradually see that throughout the season. Again, every episode, it's like it starts off every now and then with a bit of just kind of what's going on the ship, you know, what new skills Omega's learning from the Bad Batch, you know, that kind of thing. And here we see her, you know, we see what she's really capable of. We see her potential start to get realized. One of the really good things about this episode, though, which absolutely puts it in an S rank for me, I'm really sorry, I know I'm being too generous, but I have to put this in an S rank, is that it's one of the few episodes, one of the only episodes in the whole series where we actually get to follow Crosshair as well. Because Crosshair is a member of the Bad Batch. Like, not, he is a member of the Bad Batch. Maybe not in the same way, but he, at the very, very least, he was a member of the Bad Batch. And this episode actually goes back and forth between the perspective of the Bad Batch. If everything I said on its own had just been the episode, it would have been, like, okay. But what really puts this in the S rank is that we get to see what's going on with Crosshair. We get to see what the Empire has done with him. We see his first mission. We see the new elite task force of non-clones. Project War-Mantle, the beginning of, like, the Stormtrooper, like, you know, development, where the Republic moves from the clone army to a Stormtrooper army. It's the Empire. It's the Empire now. So we see, like, Crosshair take an elite squad of non-clones, like a very experimental project. We see this being led by Admiral Rampart, who's like the main antagonist of the series. He's a great, like, Imperial officer stereotype, archetype. And we get to see how brutal the Imperial regime really is. Like, it does not hold back. And we get to see how much of a monster that Crosshair has made with the inhibitor chip. Again, I know you guys can't see this, so I'm not going to switch. I'm just going to stay on this perspective. There's no point because you guys can't see it. But we get to see Crosshair commit war crimes. We get to actually see him execute one of his own squad for not following orders. And he repeats the mantra, good soldiers follow orders. And it's a great use of the line because it's like, this time it's not just the inhibitor chip mind-washing and getting him to say it. It's a threat to the others. And he says, you know, finish the mission. So, like, we get to see a bit of the how the inhibitor chip works. We get to see more of Crosshair. You know, his personality hasn't changed. He's just more obedient. That's really all that's changed. It's still Crosshair. Crosshair still does this willingly. He also has really nice, badass new armor. I gotta say, I like Crosshair's Imperial armor more than his regular one. The regular one was really cool, but I actually like the Imperial one quite a lot. Really suits him. I like the visor and the like, antennae and stuff. And, yeah, it's really interesting, and it's like, you know, they complete the mission, they succeed the mission. It isn't properly explained that Crosshair shot one of his own officers. The other, he keeps the other three too scared to say anything. So Tucker's just like, well, he knew the risks. You know, they do have potential. And so this is where Tarkin leaves the picture. Again, they don't overuse such a big Star Wars character, which is nice. And it kind of, you know, after a few episodes now of introducing him and introducing Admiral Rampart, who was introduced, I think in this episode, actually, Rampart was introduced, I think, in Aftermath or Cut and Run. He was in the first one or two episodes. But either way, Rampart is basically given the baton. Tarkin's like, I've got more important business to attend to, so you are in charge now. The project is in your hands. And he gives him promotion to Admiral, because he was like governor before or something. So it's a nice arc for him. And this is where we start getting stuff from the Kaminoans. We get start getting, again, there's lots of little subplots in this, which all tie into the main narrative really nicely. This is where we start getting Lamassu and Nalase talking about Phase 3. And it's kind of hints that, oh, they need to get the Bad Batch back to stay in business because the Empire is looking to end their contract. And, you know, tensions between the Kaminoans and, you know, the Empire increase as the series goes on. It's just, it's very interesting because this series, has political intrigue. I'm going to stop rambling. I've spent like half an hour on just the first three episodes. This was supposed to be like a short hour long stream. I tell you what. I'm just going to briefly talk about where I'd place these, and then we can talk about it afterwards, okay? If you guys agree or disagree. So, back up to here. Episode 4, Cornered. Now, Cornered is where these guys need to go on a supply run. They've decided, well, we've got to fit in somewhere in the galaxy. You know, we've run away from the Empire. We've been stranded. There's been some time that's passed now. And the Bad Batch has really got to find their footing, so what do? They decide to do what they do best and become mercenaries. Private mercenaries, because being a soldier is all they know, but they don't have a republic they can rely on for backing anymore. So, you know, they try, you know, and, you know, integrate into society as kind of like, you know, civilians. You know, we get to see more of, you know, the chain codes being put in place. We get to see Fennec Shand from The Mandalorian, which was an interesting tie-in. You know, there's this whole subplot of Echo being disguised as a droid, because he's like a cyborg. And, you know, he helps repair the ship with like a team of droids, you know, that belong to the guy they sold them to. It's pretty funny. It's a good use for Echo. And, you know, this episode isn't stellar, but, like, I think it was the best it could be, reasonably. Like, not every episode needs to be an utter banger. So I'm not going to give this an S rank because, you know, it doesn't do incredible bounds and leaps, but there's already been a decent amount of character development, you know. Hunter has to rescue Omega from a bounty hunter who's trying to capture her for some reason, you know. Tech, Wrecker, they all get their funny lines of dialogue, and that's pretty much it. And, you know, that again is connected to the overall. I think I'd still give it an S rank. Oh, not an A rank, sorry, honestly. Like, Cornered is not a bad episode. It's a fairly average Bad Batch episode. But this is the one, I believe, where Sid is introduced. Am I right? No, Sid isn't introduced in this one. This is where Fennec Shand is introduced. They got to save Omega, repair the ship. It's a lot of the very same kind of, like, video game logic. Oh, well, now we've got to do this. Now we've got to do this. But, you know, the kind of tone of this series is that it's kind of like you get to see the day-to-day life of these characters. And I don't know if that's a bad thing. I think you have to moderate it. And it does get repetitive later on. But so far, the series is still going strong, in my opinion. We come to Episode 5, Rampage. This is where they give Omega a comm device and they meet Sid. And Omega, through her fantastic perception, is the only one who actually find out who Sid is, because Sid is a contact who helped the Jedi during the Clone Wars, but she's kind of out of business now. And, you know, Echo's the one who knows about this. So Echo tells him about Sid. He's never actually met Sid, though. Omega worked out who Sid is. I think Sid was a really refreshing character. I thought Sid was really interesting, actually. A Trandoshan, you know, woman who is kind of like, not a crime boss. It's not like Jabba, but she's like, you know, like a mafia boss kind of thing. I don't know how to say it. It's not like what they're doing is strictly illegal, but I mean, the Empire is, you know, very authoritarian, so it probably is now. But it's like, she decides that, you know, in return for supplies that they need, food, shelter, you know, ammunition, that kind of thing, they can work for her. And at first they're like, no, this isn't right, but that's because, you know, they're not used to, you know, they're not used to this. They used to just work for the Republic, and it's like they don't understand. But it is a mutually beneficial agreement. So they go on this mission to rescue Muchi, who turns out to be possibly the Rancor from Return of the Jedi, or at least the mother of the Rancor, because this episode has a cameo from Bib Fortuna, who was Jabba's like right-hand man. And he actually comes to Sid and he's like, where's Muchi? Where's Muchi? Where's our money? And there's also the Zygerian slavers who are in Clone Wars, like, Season 5. They make a return. Again, lots of nice tie-ins, lots of details, and, you know, not so much on the character development side, because we've already had that, but a good bit of the plot development. This is, like, another step. Oh, so, you know, they have to work for, like, as mercenaries now, and this is their first mission. And, you know, all the characters get their moments, except Echo, sadly. But, you know, this is really just plot development rather than character development. So, I think I'm going to give it a B. Rampage was cool. Rampage was fun. It wasn't, you know, outstanding. I can't keep giving them all S rank, guys, as much as I'd love to. But, you know, it was okay. And, again, maybe it could have been improved with a bit more character development. Again, I feel like there should have been an episode maybe focused on Tech. An episode focused on Echo that, you know, actually fulfilled its potential. We'll talk about that later. Again, I don't have much criticism of these first few episodes because they go through all the paces that you would logically expect them to and that they need to for the later episodes to work. And I don't really, honestly, see any problem with it. It's really the third quarter of the season that I have problems with, and possibly this episode. Let me just remind myself. So episode 6 is called Decommissioned, and this one, they're still working for Sid. This kind of becomes like the status quo. It's like, oh, it's another Sid mission, and there's kind of a bit too much of this. But, you know, they also have, like, the funny duo in the cantina who are, like, part of the scenery. They're quite funny. I like the... It's the I can't remember their names, but the two, like, pirate dudes. They also start off with Omega training with, like, the crossbow that she got from the Zygerians, then placing bets on it. Echo, like, teaching her, again, really building her character, showing that, you know, she's practicing, she's gradually improving, she's not suddenly great because she's got, you know, plot armor. And yeah, basically, they go on another mission to steal a tactical droid head, and we actually get cameos of battle droids of the Separatists for the last time, which is really cool, in like a rundown facility, I believe it's on Corellia. And then weirdly enough, the Martez sisters come back. Now, I'm gonna be dead honest here and say that I do not like the Martez sisters, they fucking suck. Like, they're just annoying. And like, they didn't need to be annoying. They could have been, like, interesting characters with depth, but instead they opted to make these two cardboard cutout joke teen girls who are just infuriating because they're so just, I don't know. Like, they're just annoying characters. They're just unlikable. They're selfish, they're, you know, irrational. I'm not sure who I like less, Trace or Rafa, but they're both annoying as fuck. In the Bad Batch, they at least have a reason to be there, as opposed to Clone Wars Season 7, where they were pretty much just, like, filler content. But, and we did get that immortal joke of, it feel like there's an Echo in here! Yes? What? Echo! That's my name, I'm Echo! I love that moment, but, yeah, I don't know. We also get the first sign of Wrecker's inhibitor chip malfunctioning, because he's been having headaches, and he starts repeating the mantra of good soldiers, and it's actually terrifying. But then he just snaps out of it, and no one notices. No one notices. Again, something with the fight sequences as well. A lot of people complained in the season that the Bad Batch felt underpowered, and if you look at it from a military tactical point of view, it's actually because Crosshair's missing. The sniper is also kind of like the scout. He can get a bird's eye view of everything, and he can really organize the tactics a lot better, even if Hunter is their leader. But sadly, he's gone, which means that they're a bit underpowered, because Echo can't really replace him. And Echo as well is kind of just like, you know, like a droid here. He's just like the you know, oh, he's got his arm thing that he says. Why can't he have a proper hand? Why is Techo gotta have this shitty little pistol and, like, only one hand? And also, like, it's like the people who made this didn't watch Clone Wars before Season 7, because Echo has a comment about, like, never thought we'd see droids fighting on our side, when we literally saw him before we got blown up at the Citadel, back in the Clone Wars, fighting side by side with reprogrammed droids. Remember R2-D2 squad? He also, I think, fought with droids on another occasion, which I can't quite remember. But Echo was just kind of given the shaft in the show, which is really sad, because everything else is absolutely stellar. You know, there's good stakes, there's a good conflict. At the end of the episode, you know, the Martez sisters are fighting with the Bad Batch for the tactical droid head. The tactical droid head is sadly destroyed, but they have a backup of it, just one backup. And Hunter decides to give it to the sisters because he knows that they will use it for good. Because he had this debate with, you know, Sid earlier. You know, we don't know who is going to be using this tactical droid head or what it's going to be for. You know, it's got the knowledge to defeat clones, which is, you know, valuable information at this period of time when, you know, the Empire is creating enemies and they've got an army of clones. So he decides to actually give it to them because he feels like they're creating, like, a rebellion. Whereas, you know, Sid might have been selling it to gangsters who are going to use it, you know, to exploit, you know, innocent people. And he comes back to, you know, Sid empty-handed. There's also a tease of Rex at the end of this. And, yeah. Again, at this point, I'm starting to notice how underutilized Echo is compared to everyone else and how much missed opportunity there is and inconsistency. And the Martez sisters are bloody annoying, alright? They're just rubbish characters. Like, you could have just made them decent characters. Why, Filoni? Why? Why, Dave? You did everything else perfectly. Everything else is great, though. It does forward the plot, so I gotta give it a B. I think a C, B, I don't know. I mean, character development, it doesn't really have any, but it doesn't need any, because it's been very character-heavy in the first few episodes. But then again, you know, I think Echo, there could have been more character event with Echo here. I'm gonna give it a C. I'm gonna give it a C. Now, the next episode of Battle Scars. Did I just close the tab. Let me get that back up. I need a Bad Batch, please. Just catch up with chat as well. It's been pretty quiet, but yeah. You never got round to it, Libby. Oh, man. Hello, Rams. Thanks for joining. Guys, if you haven't watched Bad Batch yet, just come back after you've seen it. It's a great show, and I highly recommend it, okay? I would recommend watching Clone Wars first, though. You have to watch Clone Wars. Like, there's a lot of Clone Wars episodes you gotta watch, for context. But, yeah. So, that's, like, the first half, almost. Battle Scars. So, in Episode 7, We get the return of Captain Rex, which is fantastic. Or I guess he was Commander, technically. He's really just Rex now. Rex the Chad. We get some banter from them at the start, as always. Again, Sid needs him for another mission. This is the third time now. It's starting to get repetitive. I actually don't remember how this one starts. Oh, yeah, no. There's a disruption in the cantina. Oh, yeah, there's the joke of Rekka and Omega spending tons on Mantel mix and the guys being in, like, massive debt because of it. But it's revealed that a Rex has tracked down the Bad Batch in the cantina, keeping an extremely low profile. He's presumed dead. We learned that from Tech. Like, he's presumed dead, missing in action by the Empire. So that explains, like, what Rex has been up to. And we don't have a clear picture of what he's up to. But throughout the season, he's coming and going. And we're getting an idea that, given his connections, he's pretty much forming a proto-rebellion. That's what Rex is doing. He's, like, the Alpha clone, creating, like, a resistance to the Empire. However, what goes from like an amicable meeting immediately ramps up the tension, which is really good and, you know, fitting with Rex's arc, because he immediately is taken by Omega, who is like perceptive, like, oh, you're a Gen 1 clone, wrinkles on your forehead, and he's like, they immediately like get along, he's like, ah, you're a funny little kid. And then he notices Rex's headache over here, and he goes for his blaster, because he has seen the worst of what the inhibitor chips can do. And he's very, very tense. The tension just rockets up and it's fantastic. The pacing is fantastic because he's immediately on guard, literally blocking them from Omega. He's already protective of the child because he's afraid that at any moment the clones are gonna start, you know, attacking them for being like traitors and, you know, violating Order 66. And it's a brilliant, really rich character moment for Rex. This is just me fanboying, but no. He takes them to a ship graveyard. It's the same planet from Fallen Order when Cal Kestis is probably just like a baby at this point. No, sorry, when was he born? He's already a teen at the end of the Clone Wars. No, Cal Kestis is presumably a teen at this point. And he basically goes to take them to get rid of their inhibitor chips, because the inhibitor chips have still been in the Bad Batch all this time. You know, Wreckers has been malfunctioning. Hunter, Tech, and Echo have had pretty much nothing happening, but the risk is always there. So this underlying plot thing is going to get resolved in this episode. Now, there's another sad missed opportunity with Echo, because there's this one-liner. There's this one-liner between Rex and Echo, and it's like, you know, they mentioned Fives, because this all goes back to Fives. Fives is the one who, you know, discovered the inhibitor chips and got Rex to know and got Soka to know and kind of followed the chain since, like, Season 6. And they just pass it off as like, yeah, still can't believe what happened. And it's like, Fives was Echo's closest buddy. They were raised together from birth. They were the only survivors of Domino Squad. You know, Fives thought Echo was dead for years. And they had the opportunity to address this in a really tragic moment for Echo in Season 7. And they had the opportunity to address this in the Bad Batch. And they just kind of side it off like, oh, well, Rex must have addressed this off camera. Because Echo kind of trucks off like, yeah, still can't believe what happened to, like, Fives. And Echo never found out that Fives died on camera. And that's such a big missed opportunity. Because, like, when would he have found out between Season 7 and Bad Batch? Did he contact Rex at some point? Like, they could have had a massive character moment for Echo in the show, or in Clone Wars Season 7 even, and we never got it, and it really sucks, because, like, Echo's just kind of there for most of this season. And again, I gotta mark the episode down for that, because Echo is a really important character in the Star Wars canon, in the Clone Wars. He's massively important, you know, or he should have been, rather, massively important to the Bad Batch, but he isn't very important, because he doesn't really do or say much that's consequential now. Like, he was so close to Fives, and he was so involved in a lot of the early Clone Wars stuff, and he came back, but it's like, nothing. You don't really get anything. It's a real disappointment. Anyway. God, sorry, there's a hair in my mouth. But the, there's some, you know, tensions. Rek has a fear of heights, and this is something that is actually consistently, you know, remembered at the show. Rek has a fear of heights, which is brilliant. Nice little character detail. Give them fears, give them motivations. You know, Tech as well. Some people have criticized the show for, like, not really giving Tech any character motivation, but I think there's a reason for that. Tech is, to put it politely, he's basically autistic. Tech has, like, no emotional radar. He's purely logic. He has no feelings. And, you know, he's a good soldier, and he's very rational, very intelligent, but he has, like, no emotional intelligence whatsoever. So when Omega Star tries to start a conversation with him to say, like, you know, oh, what was the war like? And he's like, well, it was an overall strategic objective fought on a number of fronts. And she was like, no, but what did it feel like? And then they get interrupted before they can continue. He's like, oh, well, I just told you, because he literally does not understand. But I think the thing is, Tech is the type of character that doesn't need an arc. He doesn't need development. He stays consistent throughout the whole show. That's his arc, because he doesn't, because of his character, because of these genetic modifications, he doesn't really feel. And it's like, that's not to say he's not an endearing character. He's unintentionally funny all the time. I love him. He's endearing in a funny kind of way. But like, he's less emotional than most of the droids in Star Wars. And I think the whole point was that he's always the same and that he doesn't get an arc because he just can't. Maybe that will change. Maybe some emotion will be revealed. Like, something I'd love to see, honestly, if they could pull it off without being cringy, is to give Tech a romantic interest. I think that'd be really funny. If they pulled that off in season 2, if they could give him a romantic interest, like some other science nerd. People have already started, like, making jokes about him and the lady with the similar goggles, who's working for the Empire at the end of the teaser. It'd be really funny if they fell in love, I think. But that's for another time. But other than that, yeah, we get Wrecker. Wrecker's inhibitor chip activates, and it's absolutely terrifying. His character completely changes. We really get to see how the brainwashing works, and what an absolute tank that Wrecker can be, you know, when he is, like, you know, has his personality stripped away. And there's a whole sequence. Rex saves Omega from being killed by Wrecker. It's very dark, and it's absolutely incredible. And they get the other chips removed. Massive plot development again. Pretty much finishing off the Omega Wrecker character arc, because those two had a really interesting development where they got really close, and then, like, this was the thing that, like, Omega had a gun pointed at Wrecker, and he did have a gun pointed at, but she didn't want to shoot because she knew it wasn't, he wasn't under the control, and she got saved by Rex, thankfully, with a stun blast. And yeah, I think battle scars, missed opportunities with Echo constantly, but it's still an A rank for everything else. I think Rex's arc, Hunter, and, you know, his, you know, I haven't talked too much about Hunter as well, but missing the point, but he's like the main character of the show. He, all of his development, I think, happens at the start, but that's fine. The way he responds to everything, it's very interesting. He has like a solo moment with Rex later on, talking about, like, you know, and Echo as well. He's like, you know, Echo's like, we're soldiers, whatever the way path for us is there. And he's like, no, this is our path now. We're not going to be fighting anymore. We're going to be, you know, our own people. Because Echo wants to join Rex. He wants to join this proto-rebellion thing. He's, you know, Echo is the most, because again, Echo is actually a Reg. He's an ARC trooper. He's very loyal. And he's, you know, Echo wants to, you know, stand for something. Whereas Hunter really just wants to take care of himself and take care of Omega. He wants to take care of the, you know, the team. And, you know, Tech is kind of indifferent. He just does what's logical and thinks what's logical. And, you know, Wrecker just kind of goes along. He's a bit unsure. You know, he's not a thinker. So it's a really good just overall team dynamic that they have. It's really cool to see. Then we get to episode 8, Reunion. And this is one of the most awesome episodes. We finally see Crosshair again. Something that I was hoping to see in every episode, which didn't pan out, was like a bit of Crosshair. Just kind of keeping in touch. Where's Crosshair? The Empire manages to track them down. And Crosshair leads a few squads to find. We also see some of the tension rising between Rampart and Lamassu, like, you know, the Kaminoans and, you know, the Empire. Let's see, Wrecker, you know, does a bomb defusal lesson with Omega. Again, more character development. You know, Echo as well is kind of being like a guide, being like the sensible one with those two. It's the three of them out there, you know. They fight some pirates. Those pirates contact the Empire. They go to loot a ship because it's got loads of valuables. This is the episode where Tech has that conversation with Omega I was talking about, where it's like, what was the war like? And he doesn't really give like a proper answer. And then the Empire arrives and it is absolutely menacing. Seeing Crosshair in like the grey-blue light with all of these like darkly uniformed troopers. And he's like elite smarts above the rest. It's amazing. And the Bad Batch has to escape this, like, Venator class, like, you know, the Star Destroyer, well, the Republic thing they had before that, like the ship. And there's like a load of great fight sequences, some like hide and seek, basically. And they pull off some really smart strats. And they eventually try and leave through the engines, but Crosshair has them blocked. And then he ignites the engines from the other side. He gets a troop to ignite him, so they're basically, he's gonna flame them out. And we get to see how angry and vengeful Crosshair is for being left behind here, but also how the inhibitor chip is kind of making him such a, like, you know, a bitter and really, like, you know, determined soldier. So, on the spot, the Bad Batch have to... There's also this amazing panning cinematic shot, which I wish we got more of, which looks really cool. They have to quickly form a plan. They all have their bits of dialogue, and then they decide, okay, let's blow up the engine with the explosives we've got. We'll leave without the treasures, but we'll live. And they basically split it in half so that they're able to, like, kind of fall. The entire plan backfires. Crosshair and a bunch of troopers get blasted by their iron engines. He gets radiation poisoning. His face gets loads of scars. And he gets, like, a concussion as well. So the plan completely backfires, and Crosshair gets loads of, like, really bad injuries. And then in yet another plot twist at the end... This is an S round, by the way. Not only is this, like, daring escape mid-season climax... turning point for Crosshair, because this is where his inhibitor chip stops working, I'm sure of it. Someone else shows up. Another bounty hunter shows up to steal Omega, and it's not Fennec Shand. It's Cad Bane. Cad Bane, who we have not seen since, what, Clone Wars Season 4, Season 5? It's been the best part of a decade. This is the only time I've ever actually freaked out watching this show. I was, like, jumping up and down, screaming in my chair. My siblings came up to check on me because they could hear, like, World War II noises in my room, because I was ecstatic. Cad Bane has not been seen in such a long, long, long time. And to see him return here in the high quality animation, to find out where he's been, because his arc where he dies in the duel with Boba was never released, so it's not sure, its canonicity is kind of wobbly. And he's still alive after the end of the Clone War, and we found out what he's up to, kind of. And we get a glimpse of him, and this was really exciting. This was an extremely hype moment. And the stakes get set really high when Omega is kidnapped. Cad Bane defeats Hunter in a one-on-one. There's this amazing Republic Commando reference with the visor. It has the same sound effects, the same UI. The Bad Batch escape, but Omega's been kidnapped, and they have no way of tracking her down. And it's, like, really high stakes, really interesting dynamic, really exciting mid-season climax. It's an absolute reunion is an S rank. If I can get a but, honestly, I might actually have an SS tier for some of these. I'm not sure. Reunion was just, like, the best episode. And that brings us to Bounty Loss. Now, Bounty Loss was good. It was not as good, but it was good. Again, I'm just looking back on this. The duel and everything, it was just, it was really good. A very, like, Wild West as well. I like how Cad Bane's like a space cowboy. Next stream's in still over now. We're gonna have time. A little time to finish the stream. So, you know what, guys? I'm actually gonna take a break because I think we're halfway through the stream and we've talked about half the episodes. And I've just been kind of rambling and I haven't really had much from chat. If you guys want to engage with this or agree, disagree, please let me know. But, like, this is my opinion. Like, I really like the Bad Batch overall and it had some lows and we will get to them. I know I've been a bit generous and they're not very critical so far, but just you wait. I promise I'm treating all the episodes equally here. But, like, in my mind, Reunion was probably the perfect episode. Like, I cannot think of a thing wrong with it. Like, I didn't even have missing Echo character development because it was kind of focused on the plot, so the character development had already happened. It didn't matter too much. Again, if Echo had been a bit more developed earlier on, these would pretty much all have been S rank. And if, like, the, you know, Martez sisters were written better, again, this kind of ties back to Season 7 of the Clone Wars, and, you know, if the Sid missions didn't get so repetitive, but, like, this is a really good series. Things like Hunter's character, things like the plot, they're very consistent, mostly. There's a few exceptions, which we'll get to, but yeah. That's half the episodes. I'm going to talk about the second half in a moment. I just want to ask you guys all now, if you haven't already, leave a like, subscribe if you're enjoying, share this to your friends if you know someone who would enjoy this, and check out the links in the description. I have a meme channel and a clip channel. If you want to make memes or clips of my content, you can upload them over to here. I have other social medias. I have a Fiverr if you want to buy my services. I have a Discord and Instagram for notifications. The tier list is there. And today's charity shout-out goes to the Trussell Trust. Funny fun fact, guys, I actually got a letter from these guys. I got a letter from the Trussell Trust just a few days ago, so I'm going to read this out. The link is in the description, guys. They're a food bank based in the UK and a charity that you should absolutely donate money to if you can, because you'll be helping people who have this to say. You know, there are people starving, unemployed, homeless in the UK, and the government's doing jack shit. Jackal, whatever the phrase is. You know, fuck all. I can't remember what it is. They're doing now, alright? They're doing nothing. But imagine I'm, like, swearing to really put the point across. you know. So we got to rely on charities like these. And if you can't donate, or you've already donated, share it. Share the message. You know, too many people face impossible decisions between eating and paying their bills this winter. Will you help us fight hunger near you and across the UK? And oh my god, everything's falling all over the place. But they sent a letter to me. Presumably, maybe because they noticed my previous donation. I have no idea. This wasn't with The Guardian. But like, guys, some of them are able to afford one but not the other. Can you imagine? What would you choose? What would you choose? Probably food, because they die without it, but like, they can die from, you know, lack of heat as well. But you can't let them starve. And yeah, there's more info in here, stories and whatnot I might read out. But like, there are thousands of people, hundreds of families struggling in the winter. They're struggling during the summer. How are they going to cope now things are worse in the winter? And it's only getting worse with new, like, government proposals. It's talking about here on, like, the £20 cut to universal credit, which is going to push hundreds of thousands of people into poverty. Huge rise in energy prices, national insurance contributions, which are disproportionately going to hit the lowest income households because they've been increased. More economic stuff. I'm not going to pretend I understand this. I need to do some more research for the context, but it says Mr. Gibbons on this. It's been written to me. Why have they written? They must have noticed my donation or something previously. Because, like, this has been written specifically to me. It says Mr. Gibbons. And, yeah. Again, I sadly don't think I can spend more money on this when I've barely got anything for myself. But, if you guys can, please, at the very least, do something. Share it, okay? Get people to donate. Ask your parents. Because it's really important that we help people in need. Alright. I will be right back. I'm just gonna go hydrate. Give me a couple minutes. And I'll see you all in a moment. All right, fellas, I'm going to be honest. I feel ill, and I think I had an asthma attack there. I was very short of breath. I don't know if anyone's still here. Chat's been completely dead, but thank you for the likes, and thank you for the watch time. Again, let's keep talking about Bad Batch, because I really love Star Wars, and the new TV shows that have come out in the last few years have really revived the franchise after those horrendous sequels. Man. Bit out of breath, guys. I was running up and down the stairs. I went to take a piss. I was pissing, alright? I was bissing. I was bussing. Bussy, alright? I was bussing. Bussing. Alright. Let's focus. So, Bad Batch, episode 9. Now, I'm gonna be honest, guys. This is the part of the series where things go downhill. There are still great episodes, but there's a few really bad episodes, relatively speaking. In the kind of like third quarter of the Bad Batch. Bounty Lost follows immediately. The Bad Batch are desperate. We get a glimpse of Crosshair, who is now like covered in bandages. He's got loads of injuries. He's like been rescued. And you know, we get a glimpse of him chasing the Bad Batch because they have to jump to hyperspace. And Hunter's like, we can't leave Omega. And he has to make this really tough choice because he, more than any of them, has grown really attached to her. They've developed this father-daughter relationship. And everyone else is thinking practically, we've got to jump to hyperspace or the Imperials are going to blast us to hell. We don't know where Omega is, so staying here isn't going to help us find her. Hunter's worried, but they make the jump and Omega's lost, so like Hunter is crushed. He is like at his most vulnerable. And meanwhile, Omega's in a prison cell with Todo. Todo is Cad Bane's droid, who was also in the Clone Wars. He's been rebuilt a few times. He got blown up as a, you know, attack on the Jedi Temple one time. But yeah, Todo's back, and Omega tricks him to let her out of the cell because she can fix his, like, booster, which presumably is a skill she's learned from tech over the last few episodes, which is really cool, because, again, she had some, like, knowledge before, but she's learned a lot more, like, practical military skills from these guys, and, like, tech skills, because it's, like, Star Wars, so there's a lot of sci-fi, you know, like, technology-like based skills. Even though she probably would have had a good foundation. Cad Bane is absolutely menacing. I just love the voice actor, man. I mean, all of them. There is not a bad character in this, except the Martez sisters. But, like, Cad Bane is really interesting. Cad Bane is, you know, just a really, really cool character. Like, Wild West cowboy kind of in space. It's interesting. And also, this is where a plot twist that has been slowly being hinted at is revealed. That Cad Bane and Fennec Shand are among a bunch of bounty hunters the Kaminoans have hired to capture Omega, because they want to protect her from the Empire. They want to use her for their own experiments without the Empire knowing. And yeah, obviously that's going to come to a point. Nala Se is also personally invested because she sees Omega as kind of a surrogate child, and she's like a surrogate mother. But Lamassu recognizes that she's too personally invested in it. So he sends Torn Way, the Kaminoan from Attack of the Clones that Obi-Wan meets on Kamino, you know, way back when the Clone War, you know, first started. He sends her to go collect Omega at this secret rendezvous point with Cad Bane. She dies. She gets killed. We also have the Bad Batch. Tech, I think, reveals to the others that, you know, he's done some research. I can't remember the exact details, but he finds out that Omega, the reason Omega is so valuable is because she has pure, unaltered Jango Fett DNA. The only other known instance of a clone like this is Alpha, who is now going by Boba, and he disappeared at the start of the Clone Wars. No one knows where he's been. And that was so cool. It's like a Boba name drop. Boba's got to be in this because he's like really relevant. They've got to have Boba Fett because that unfinished episode with Cad Bane would fit really nicely into this period of time. Maybe in season 2 because we didn't get it. And Boba is obviously very relevant to this because he has a lot in common with Omega. And like, I wonder how they would engage it. How would he interact with the characters that we know in the Bad Batch? And you know, like, you know, what is Boba up to at this time? And yeah, it's very interesting. Again, I'm gonna switch in because you guys can't see this, but it's very interesting, you know, to kind of have that name dropped. Although it's weird that he mentions that he's not been seen since the start of the Clone War, because midway through the Clone War, we do see Boba in prison. In fact, in the last episode with Cad Bane, which was season 4 or 5, that's like 20 or 20 BBY 21, you know, we see him, you know, in a Coruscant prison, you know, with Racco, Hardeen, Obi-Wan in disguise, and you know, all of those guys, and it's really interesting. So I don't know why that's been mentioned. Maybe that's just a small inconsistency, because again, I feel like the writers have forgotten about everything from Clone Wars Season 1 to 6 while making this, and they haven't paid attention. So they've forgotten a few of these details that just don't quite line up. Because they should have records of Boba being, you know, in prison for most of the Clone Wars. It seems like he was, if he wasn't on the run with Bounty Hunters, which we also saw in the Clone Wars. But again, not in Season 7. It's like they only thought about Season 7. But anyways, so using her, like, com thing, which they gave to her a few episodes back. Again, love these small tie-ins that all connect into the larger narrative. Again, really builds on the realism. You know, Omega manages to contact the Bad Batch. They go to rescue her. But it turns out Fennec Shand and Cad Bane are fighting over Omega for the money that they're going to get from the Kaminoans in, you know, return for the bounty. And it's like, oh, you don't have the experience to be going up against me. Yet I'm the one holding the package. And these two have a fight, and this is really interesting. Now, a lot of people were peeved that the up-and-coming Fennec Shand was able to take down the legendary Cad Bane so easily. But, I mean, we don't know much about Fennec Shand's backstory. I'm sure she must have a reason for being highly skilled and highly trained. And it's like, she doesn't really defeat Cad Bane, but she does honestly get the upper hand. If someone had to win this fight, it's Fennec. Cad Bane obviously has the advantage of Toto, you know. And Cad's also a quicker draw of the blaster, I think. But he's also old. If you look closely, Cad Bane has more and more, like, cybernetics now. You know, he's getting old for his age. And it's like, if he lives on into the, like, Imperial era with the Mandalorian era, he's probably going to be, like, a full robot by that time. Well, it's a very, very heavily cyborg because, you know, he's getting old. You can really tell that he's getting old. He feels like an older character than the you know, the Cad Bane we met in Season 1 of the Clone Wars. And, you know, they fight for a bit. There are these weird experimental, like, you know, creatures in tubes, which I don't know what it's about. The Kaminoans were doing some experimentation. This could connect to Legends lore, or sadly, it could connect to Rise of Skywalker. It doesn't really matter, I don't think. But we've got, like, these, like, aliens in tubes. They're kind of gross. Cad Bane literally gets knocked out for, like, 10 minutes, which is quite funny. Bit sad, really, that his character got shafted like that. I might mark it down, but Omega actually escapes with an escape pod, and it looks like she's gonna plummet to her doom, but then she gets rescued by the Bad Batch, who fly in just in time, get out of there, and, Fennec Shand also, like, sabotages Cad Bane's, like, ship and everything. He loses hard in this episode, which is kind of sad for him, and that's the last we see of the two bounty hunters, in this season, which is, you know, fair enough. I think it's a nice rounding off. And there's an interesting exchange between Fennec Shand and Nala Se. She wasn't actually hired to capture Omega, just to protect her. Nala Se has decided that Omega is safest with the Bad Batch rather than out of the hands of the Empire. So she decides to just let Omega go, which is really interesting to have one of the Kaminoans, who is supposedly one of the bad guys. I mean, she did do some pretty nasty stuff for Five. She was, you know, involved in Five's death, you know, actually protect Omega here. It was really interesting. And there's this, you know, like, brilliant, you know, father-daughter moment with Omega and Hunter here, you know, reflecting on what's just happened, on how Omega was, like, captured, kidnapped, gone. And, you know, he's like, I promise you, you're never gonna have to go back to Kamino.
You'll never guess what happens in the season finale, though.
Oh, boy. And, it's just an endearing moment. Nice cementing of the character, you know. Good way to round off the episode. Bounty lost, honestly, I'm gonna give a B? B or an A? Let me think about this. I don't know. I like it. I like all it did. It really moved the plot. The plot was moved a lot in this, which was good. I feel like Cad Bane got shafted a bit. I feel like there could have been, I don't know, I feel like Cad Bane being so easily bested by Fennec Shand is just a bit unbelievable. And I feel like maybe Fennec should have had more of an obvious advantage, because she didn't really have an obvious advantage, but then she absolutely, like, you know, finessed him. And it's like, why is Fennec so OP? There has to be a reason. I like the intrigue with the Kaminoans increasing, though. Again, there's nothing really with Crosshair of the Empire, which kind of makes sense. And I don't know, I just wish we got a bit more of the bounty hunters, really. Maybe, you know, I don't know, I feel like Cad Bane lost out a bit, and I don't know. Omega didn't really have as much to do. She could have been given, like, more to do, I guess, but in this episode, she just kind of calls for help and runs around for a bit. I don't know. I think it's a B tier. Like, I don't know why exactly, but Bounty Loss doesn't really evoke a lot of excitement in me. Like, it had a really strong setup with Reunion. Here, it was like, it's pretty good. It's enjoyable, but it's not like an A tier or anything. Like, I'm going to give it a solid B. It's with Rampage. And then we come to Common Ground. Easily the worst episode in the entire series. Not because of how bad it was, but because of missed potential. I'm going to say it one more time for the people in the back.
Echo.
Alright, I want you to L Echo Echo. This episode was so clearly designed to give Echo the character development he'd been lacking up to this point. The whole premise was that they're going on another Cid mission, which, by the way, felt like a really strange thing to do. There's like, between the end of Bounty Lost and the start of War-Mantle, there's just a couple of like filler episodes. It's really strange. They kind of feel a bit disjointed and like out of place, like we're not really moving the plot forward. The plot doesn't get moved at all in any of these episodes. Two of them are really cool though, and I'll explain why. So this is where the series really dips. Common Ground, there is no plot momentum whatsoever. So it's got to be counter momentum, right? Well, there's some good world building. We see a separatist world and what happens to, you know, Raxus Prime, the separatist homeworld, when, you know, invaded by the Empire, and how, like, its local leaders are forced to comply with the Empire. For some reason, people were simping for the, you know, woman in Imperial Officer, which is just cringe, because there's clone troopers literally all around. I mean, come on. We have a very sexy clone trooper in the upcoming episodes, just waiting to see. But yeah, we get to see, like, the terror of the Empire, more of the Cid dynamic, which, is a bit tired at this point. Because, again, Cid's cool. I like her as a character. I think Cid is a great character, and I think she's, like, tech. She doesn't need to develop or change. She's, like, staying as she is as a kind of, like, snarky, like, kind of mob boss. But, like, I don't know. Some of the interactions made me cringe a bit. It's just, like, it just feels stagnated. Like, I don't even remember what this scene was about, to be honest. Oh, yeah, this is where Hunter is like, Omega needs to stay here. It's too dangerous. Because after being kidnapped, and a natural direction for his character, really considerate of the writers, he's insisting that Omega has to stay put, stay safe. And she's protesting like, no, I want to join you guys and go on adventures. And he's like, no, Omega, no. Okay, no means no. That's an order. And, you know, he has to put his foot down, basically. So she stays with Cid, and, you know, Omega has a bit of, like, a sulk. You know, Cid's just not, clearly not equipped to be a parent or guardian in any way, shape, or form. These guys, and the thing is, the mission the Bad Batch have to go on, you know, to pay their debts to Cid, to go and get money, is to rescue a separatist leader. They have to rescue a separatist leader. And they're a bit hesitant about this, because the word separatist to them means enemy. The Bad Batch, especially Echo, who has personally suffered the most at the hands of the cruelty of the separatists, is very, very angry with this mission, and he does not want to do it. And, you know, he keeps saying, bloody separatist, I don't want to rescue a separatist. What if this is a trap? It's probably a trap. And Tekka's like, yes, we know. And the main Bad Batch have always been outcasts. They've never really bought into the Republic kind of dogma quite as much as Echo did, because he was a reg. So he's like really ingrained with the kind of Republic, like, you know, pro-Republic, anti-separatist propaganda. And this episode, we do see Echo develop. He starts off the episode saying, bloody separatists. And then at the end, he has one, and he's like, puts his hand on the shoulder of, like, the, you know, the separatist guy they're saving, you know, in a friendly way. And he says, like, you know, live to fight another day, which is a callback to Umbara, because that those were Hardcase's final words before he got blown up, you know, above Umbara, which is really sad. And I know Echo wasn't there, but if Echo knows about Five's death, Rex has probably shared a bunch of war stories with them, and, you know, Rex will have known about that. Jesse was still alive in Clone Wars Season 7, and he experienced that firsthand, because it was Jesse and Fives who were with Hardcase in that mission. So Jesse and Rex probably, excuse me, told them a bit about that. We can only presume. No. The thing is, though, it still really misses the mark, because this episode, first of all, was kind of boring. It did do some good stuff. Omega got some great character development, because it turns out she's really good at strategy, and then she wins so much money from gambling while the Bad Batch are on their mission, that she ends up paying back all their debts to Sid. And they're like, and Hunter's scolding her for not keeping a low profile. And it's just like, you should be grateful. She just paid back all of your debts. You're free from me now. And I think that's a great way to end the kind of Sid debt storyline. There's also some good combat scenes in like the kind of city setting with regular clones, you know, on with the with tanks as well. I like the, you know, the droid with the female voice who's like assistant to the like Separatist leader. I like those characters. I forget their names, and they, you know, they don't do a whole lot, of course, because they're just being rescued, but I like them. I like the humor. Like, there's a bit where she's like, oh, she catches the vase. It's like, oh no, we must save this vase. This was a gift from so-and-so. And then it like gets broken later on. And he's like, oh, I was never too, you know, I was never too fond of that vase anyway. And it's just fantastic. It's really funny. But yeah, Echo, I like that Echo is like antagonistic and suspicious at the start. But then he kind of just does what he's told for the rest of the mission, and then he just has that one line at the end to show that, oh, actually, no, I get it. You know, the Separatists, the galaxy's changed. We don't have to be enemies anymore. And it's like, you could have had a whole Echo subplot in this episode where he was so, like, you know, indoctrinated with the propaganda, despite not having an inhibitor chip, that he refused to do the mission outright, would, like, stay on the ship, and, like, would actually interfere with the mission with the others. I know he's an ARC trooper as well, which means he's a lot more individualistic than the Bad Batch, who are, like, commandos who like to work together. And, like, there could have been so much more conflict, so much more unnecessary kind of, like, risk to the mission because of Echo. And we could have seen some real flaws with Echo's character there, and I think that's a really big missed opportunity, because that would have been really cool to see. Sorry, my camera's off center. Like, we could have had Echo, like, really sabotaging the mission because he, like, is so suspicious and so paranoid because he's so anti-separatist. And it just kind of didn't happen. He just kind of did as he was told for the rest of it. And I really, really feel like there was so much opportunity for, like, one of the best character development episodes in the series. This could have been an A or an S rank for character development, but it really missed out because it didn't really have a focal point. Like, it just kind of moved from plot point to plot point, cutting back to Omega, which was really cool. That was a stronger plot than the main rescue, I think. I think the actual rescue was really filler compared to Omega doing, like, the gambling. That was the plot line that I was actually most invested in, even though it had the least spectacle. And the ending was nicely resolved, but again, massive missed opportunity, which is why I have to give this a D. I think the Omega character development was good. I think everything else, you know, the standard was held. But this was a really disappointing episode because, again, there was also opportunity, not just for Echo, but for all of the others. You know, how do they feel about rescuing a Separatist? Why are Tech, Hunter, and, oh god, is the stream lagging? I'm seeing frame drops. Why are, you know, the other three, you know, Wrecker, Hunter, Tech, so just compliant with, like, oh, okay, we'll just rescue a Separatist, no problem. Like, Hunter brings it up at the start, and then he's like, all right, fine, we'll do it, we have to. And that makes sense. Wrecker, you know, maybe he's just a bit dim and he just doesn't care. Tech was completely logical about it. He's saying, you know what, it has to be for money. You know, the Separatists are no longer their enemy. They don't really exist because the Empire is turned public now, so it doesn't matter. So I guess that makes sense, but, you know, I feel like there just could have been more. So much missed opportunity. Sorry if the stream's lagging, by the way. It looks fine now, but if it buffers again, I will keep an eye on that. I don't know why we've got 6,900 drop frames. That must have been from the break earlier. Devil's Deal is next. So the next episodes were a really interesting two-parter. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention, there's this, like, Hunt has this bet with Omega at the end. If she can beat him at, like, the chess game, then she won't be left out of missions anymore, which obviously leads to her getting captured again later, but, well, not exactly. But yeah, now, Devil's Deal was a really interesting episode, because this felt like a Clone Wars episode. The Bad Batch are not the main characters in this episode. They make a cameo appearance about halfway through, and they appear for, like, 2 or 3 minutes of the entire episode. In this episode, the premise we focus is Ryloth. We get to see Hera Syndulla from Rebels as a child with Chopper. We get to see her family, her dad, who appeared in the Clone Wars, her mum. We get to see a new clone trooper who, for some reason, doesn't seem to have been affected by Order 66 and the inhibitor chip very much. I'm forgetting all their names. Captain Hauser, he's a really cool clone. I've forgotten what Hera's dad's called, but, you know, Mr. Syndulla. We get to see all these characters and how a Republic world is treated by the Empire very, you know, pretty much the same as the Separatist world. And this is fantastic world building. We get to see Rampart doing more of his manipulating as well. We get to see an underground kind of, like, resistance movement and how, like, the tension between, no, let's just comply with the Empire. We've fought war for so long now. Can we just have peace? But you know, there's like political intrigue throughout the episode. Hera is a kid who wants to be like involved. And she ends up going on an illegal mission to get weapons. And guess which mercenaries are illegally delivering weapons to, you know, the people of Ryloth now that, you know, there's been a ban on guns, you know, on Ryloth. Now, who do you think, you know, since the Empire's taken away all the weaponry so that the Empire can defend them now, so that there are no armed, you know, natives of Ryloth, the Twi'leks. Yeah, the Bad Batch delivers the weapons, and we get to see Hera meeting Omega for a bit, and because they're both kids of the same age, they're both little girls, they're both hanging out, they both have dreams of being a pilot and flying, they get this brilliant character sequence for just a couple minutes of them talking to each other and just chatting around while, you know, the adults do business. Like, as someone who used to be a child, you know, this was a really cool moment, I really enjoyed it, I really related to it. And then later on in the episode, Hera has to run away because her family is basically arrested for traitor, like betraying the Empire. Hauser, you know, was kind of resisting orders a bit, and it's really interesting. There's a lot of good conflict. Admiral Rampart frames the Syndulas for attempting to assassinate the fat dude whose name I forget. He was in Revenge of the Sith. And yeah, it's a great two-parter setup because now Hera has to get help, and who's she gonna get help from? Bad Batch, who she met earlier, obviously. And yeah, we get to see some of the Empire's evil doing, you know, in full. Rescue on Ryloth immediately follows that up. We get to see the Bad Batch reluctantly help because, you know, they don't really have any business in this. Hunter's like, look, we gotta fend for ourselves, okay? That's what he's been about the whole season. He's been selfish. Hunter is selfish. He doesn't want to get involved and take unnecessary risks, especially because of Omega. We see Hauser struggling, you know, to follow orders with Rampart. We see Hera, you know, doing some more spying, sending her a distress signal, and Omega convinces the others to go help, you know, because Hunter can't resist the adorable little eyes of her child, his child. You know, like, Tech is advising against it. Echo's like, there's no reason for us to go, we shouldn't need to do this. And they reluctantly go and scout it out, just to see. They find an Imperial probe droid and Crosshair. Crosshair is on Ryloth with Rampart. And they're like, no, we can't get involved. Sorry, kid. We also see some of the tension between Crosshair and Hauser, because Crosshair's kind of replacing him as, like, you know, the commander, because, like, you know, he's in the role. Crosshair at this point is also looking a little bit different. He's got a scar along the side of his head, and judging by his behavior later on, it looked like the inhibitor chip might not be functioning all that well. I mean, this is just a great, it feels like a Clone Wars episode. It doesn't really follow the Bad Batch because there's no character development left for them, but we get to see loads of good, like, espionage and intrigue, and, like, there's all the, you know, the Bad Batch do their bit to help out, and the highlight of this episode is the standoff. You know, Hauser saves everyone from being ambushed by the Imperials, and he tells them to go around, you know, back through the back exit, and he goes to try and speak to his brothers because he's realized that what they're doing is wrong. And he has this speech. It's absolutely beautiful. He tells them all to stand down. He's like, what are we doing? You know, we are now, you know, fighting against the very people we're supposed to protect. And some of the clones actually comply. And this is really strange because Order 66 has happened. The inhibitor chips, do they wear out? Was there not a Jedi on Ryloth, so they never got activated? Why is Hauser not, you know, fully compliant with the Empire as the inhibitor chips have been doing? Like, we still don't know how exactly these chips work and, like, how, what the exact rules are, what is a violation of Order 66, because they've not been shown to be consistent. So the inhibitor chips are complicated, and it's absolutely fascinating from a lore and world-building, you know, standpoint. But what we get here, I know you still can't see this, it's just habit. You know, Hauser gets arrested, Crosshair actually spares him though, and he misses a bunch of shots when the Bad Batch are escaping, which is really strange because Crosshair does not miss. Why do his shots miss when he is a perfect sniper? He literally never misses. It's because he let them go. Crosshair's emotions are starting to get in the way because he got the inhibitor chip removed because of his injuries, presumably. You know, Crosshair, he's a little more forgiving now. He's not just going to execute everyone. He lets Hauser live. He lets the Bad Batch get away. We have a nice moment with Hera and Omega. I'm sure they're going to meet again. This is really interesting because we know Hera was a massive part of the rebellion later on in her life. We also get Chopper as well, committing war crimes. Funny little guy. And it's really fascinating to me that the Bad Batch met Hera canonically, that that happened. And yeah, it's a really nice two-parter episode, I think, that really does some nice world-building for Star Wars in general. And what we get after that, at the very last scene, is Rampart permitting Crosshair finally to hunt down the Bad Batch. So that two-parter, honestly, it wasn't outstanding, but I'd say they were pretty much even, and they did a lot for world-building as well as plot. I think I'd give them both an A. Devil's Deal and Rescue and Ryloth, I liked both of them. Devil's Deal was really refreshing as well, because the Bad Batch were barely in it. It was a really interesting way to do an episode, because that doesn't happen often. I've seen it in Doctor Who, it rarely happens. But I love Hauser and the Syndulas and you know, seeing Rampart, you know, at his peak. You know, I think it was a really solid two-parter that was a nice breather before the finale, as opposed to Common Ground and Infested, which I already know is a D, if not an E, which were just shitty one-offs, really. Infested was the next episode, and this kind of had no reason to exist. Basically, the Bad Batch come back from another mission, and Sid has been replaced. Someone has taken over Sid's cantina, so they've got to win it back. And there's a bunch of, like, funny shenanigans where they've, oh, they've got to do this mission because, you know, they're in debt to Sid, who is in debt to Roland Durand, whatever his name is, who is in debt to the Pikes. The one cool thing about this is that the Pikes were in it, which might be leading to Darth Maul later on. If you guys remember from, you know, Clone Wars Season 10, Rebels, you know, it's Clone Empire's falling. But yeah, Roland isn't really, he's an okay character. You know, it could have been Visago or someone. It could have at least been someone that was relevant, you know, like from Rebels. It could be like backstory for him to connect the universe a bit. But no, it's just a random new character. We actually get to see the two dudes who are always hanging out in the cantina actually be involved in the plot, which was quite funny. Because, like, they, like, steal Roland's pet as a distraction while the Bad Batch go and... It basically revolves around gathering some spice. And I don't know. It's a good, like, one-off, but it, like, it does pretty much nothing to develop any of the characters. They are pretty much the same start to finish. It doesn't set anything up, as far as I'm aware. The main plot is completely ignored. It's just, I don't know. It's like how you don't do, like, a one-off. Like, it just felt like a filler. It really was a filler. And there were some cool things, but, like, it was just kind of, eh, you know, really just completely unremarkable. The only thing I think that could possibly validate this is if they build up Roland Durand as some important character later on, and this has to happen, if this leads to more appearances of the Pikes and some kind of plot line showing us what is going on with Darth Maul during this period of time. You know, Clone Wars Season 7... His last appearance, you know, in chronology was like a year ago, 2 years ago maybe, by the time season 2 rolls around. What's he up to? That would be a really interesting thing to happen. And I don't think, you know, they should just shove in every character they can for fan service. But if they could actually work out a plotline that involved Darth Maul as just a cameo maybe, or, you know, something interesting to do with the criminal organizations, maybe Jabba as well, the Pikes, and what's really delving knee-deep into, like, the crime syndicates of, like, the early Imperial period, rather than focusing on Darth Maul, maybe having him as a cameo at some point, I feel like that would be really cool. I feel like that would make for a great, you know, two-parter maybe in Season 2, but if that doesn't happen, this episode was all for nothing. I'm sure there's a plan. Because I trust Dave Filoni and the people making this. They're really good, but Infested sucked. Even if it's valid, it's still kind of lame as a solo episode. So that's a D. That's a D. And yeah, moving on to the next episodes. Can I please skip ahead? No, it won't let me. Will it let me? Okay. War-Mantle. 3 episodes left to go, guys. I know I'm streaming Sister Location in half an hour as well. I haven't forgotten. I'm just going to message Lucy about that. Because I might be late starting that. Oh, wait, no, she hasn't messaged me. It's fine. Also, Platy, I see that you're live. I'll check that out when I've got time. I'm just going to finish my own stream. Hello, Rams. So, these last 3 episodes. War-Mantle. After receiving a mysterious distress call, the Batch tracks it to a secret facility. This episode had an awesome beginning. Because Rex is back, okay? Rex gets a transmission from Rex. It starts off, actually, with this brilliant, mysterious sequence of a clone running away from, like, some dudes with, like, dogs and getting stunned twice. We don't know who he is. We don't know what's going on. But it's just another day on the ship. Rex contacts the Bad Batch, and it's like, he seems like he's in the middle of something. And he quickly explains that he has a clone trooper that needs rescuing, another defector. And there's this brilliant sequence of all the Batch giving their arguments on, and it's a really funny meme. It's like, you know, Rex is like, you have to do this, okay? And like, Hunter's like, I'm not sure, is it worth it? Tekka's like, we can't do this. Sid has insisted, you know, that we, if we do this now, we'll abandon the mission. No money from Sid. No, not completing the mission means no money from Sid. No money from Sid means no food, no supplies. And then Meg's like, no, but we've got to help him because I'm empathetic. And it's like, Hunter's still unsure. Right now he's in the middle. And each time someone speaks, Wrecker's like, yeah, well, Kid's got a point. He's got a point. And Wrecker's just like, I don't know. And that leaves Echo. And this is the best Echo moment in the whole series because he actually plays a massive part in this episode. Echo is the first one to speak. He's like, if Rex didn't tell us about this, you know, if Rex is telling us about this, it's important. If it wasn't this important, Rex wouldn't be contacting us. And then he leans in and he gives Hunter this stare. And that is the thing that convinces Hunter, all right, Rex said it was important, we're gonna go. So they go and do the mission, and they discover something amazing. This is amazing world building and plot building, you know, as well as character development, especially for Echo. I'm so happy. We get some cuts back to Kamino. Kamino is being evacuated, it's being cleared, it's being emptied, and there's some disturbing moments with, like, the cadets being led off. It's like, what happens to the clones? You know? And, like, Lama, Sue, and Nell are having a secret meeting, and it's like, you know, the Empire is conspiring against us. We can no longer rely on them. And he's basically saying, gather the essential supplies. We are escaping. We're leaving. But the Empire catches them. Now, the door is soundproof. You know, because they start speaking as soon as it's shut. But what happens, I think it happens later on. I'll come back to it then. There's some cool things which happen later on. Basically, they get discovered by Rampart. And he's like, a scientist we have use for. A politician, I do not. So they take Nalase, they capture Nalase. She's now going to be a scientist forced to work for the Empire. Kind of like, I guess, maybe Nazi scientists forced to work for the US after World War II, that kind of thing. And then two of the, like, early, like, Death Troopers, like the grey, like, non-clones, they walk into the room with... what's his name? Nalase, Lama Su, and the door shuts, and there's no sound because it's soundproofed. But judging by their weapons, yeah, Lama Su has been executed by the Empire because they no longer have a use for him. And it just shows Rampart being like, you know, scheming evil guy. It's great. So we get that, and throughout the episode, the Bad Batch discovers something hidden inside a mountain. They split up because they just want to scout. And again, we get Hunter's kind of self-preservation kicking in. No, we don't need to do this. We don't need to venture and it's too dangerous. There's no point. Echo, Hunter, and Tech take a look. And they find an Imperial facility with clones, with upgraded armor and loads of commandos. Clone commandos. And this is why I've been wanting to play this game. Who here has been watching Star Wars Republic Commando? Because this plays into it in a massive way. They decide to infiltrate the facility because Echo insists. And this is what Echo should have been doing in the Common Ground episode. He puts his foot down. He's like, no, we have to go check it out. If there is one clone, if there is one chance of one clone in there who needs being rescued, we have to go get him. Because that's what you did for me. If you didn't rescue me back in Season 7, if you didn't help me from capture the Separatists, I would still be in there. You know, being a war machine programmed by the Separatists, you know, from the whole arc in Season 7. And that is the character building that we need for Echo, which is why this is probably an S rank. Because, as well as some great character art for Echo, we get some real, like, New Hope vibes, some, like, original trilogy vibes from the design of the hallways and stuff. They do some research. They rescue the clone in question, who is a clone commando. The clone in question is Gregor. Gregor, who hasn't appeared since, what, Season 5? We thought he died. He was the, like, the one who had amnesia, and he got rescued by, like, the, you know, Republic captain with, like, the droid squad containing R2, and we thought he died, but it turns out that he did somehow make his way back at some point, and he just had serious injuries that have made him a bit cuckoo. But, this facility is hosting Project War-Mantle, which was mentioned earlier, hence the title. The other dudes in suits are not clones. There are non-clones being trained by commandos to replace them. And this is fantastic world building. And the dialogue is gradually happening as we're escaping. So they have a bit of dialogue. There's a fight. They have a bit of dialogue on the lift. And Greg is explaining, like, there are replacements. They're not as skilled, but there's an endless supply of them. And then Hunter's like, numbers aren't everything. And then they open the door. They open the door in the lift. And a clone commando with painted armor turns around with a squad of TK troopers. These are the very first stormtroopers, guys. This facility is holding the very first TK troopers ever seen. Now, I don't know if you can see this down here. You probably can't. Yeah, that's sad. Can I? A snipter won't work with it. But if you guys look this up, as well as it's been world-building for how the stormtroopers replace the clones, the first stormtroopers being rolled out in like a secret facility on a secret planet on a secret mountain, as well as Gregor being a defective commando who's decided, you know, he's not going to follow orders and train these guys because reasons, he doesn't like the Empire, maybe because his inhibitor chip is damaged in the explosion. You've got these great connections to the Clone Wars, and you have Scorch from Delta Squad in this episode. We don't hear him speak, but the armor is unmistakably that of Scorch's from Republic Commando, the game that I have been doing a Let's Play and live streaming, finally, in the last couple weeks. So, one of Delta Squad is here, and that is really interesting, because that opens up a lot of questions. Where is Delta Squad? Delta Squad is canon? Is the same exact events of the game's canon? Are the characters still the same as they were in canon? Are they just being used in a different setting? Where are the others? Is Scorch is here? Where is, Boss, Sev, and Fixer? Where are they? And it's really, really interesting that Scorch is here. And there's this great, like, escape thing. It's like a really fun, like, rescue mission episode. Much better than... It's like a better version of the Common Ground episode. Like, it's a really cool rescue mission. Loads of good, like, dialogue and world building done at a decent pace that isn't boring to watch. With the, you know, really well animated action sequences. And, you know, this is, again, like, reunion. Because the stakes are super high. One of them doesn't make it out. There are lots of Imperial forces on them. And... we actually see Omega piloting the ship and taking the initiative here. Tech takes back control, because obviously she's not expert enough to keep it steady long enough. But we actually see, you know, Omega piloting the ship with Wrecker. And, you know, Wrecker's teaching her how to be relaxed before, you know, going in. And, you know, just good military training. Just life training, aren't we, guys? I mean, he gives us some good advice, you know, like an older brother, I guess. Even though he's technically younger. But, yeah, so they escape. They have to get off the landing pad, but there's so many ships on them. And they end up getting everyone on board except Hunter. And Hunter makes the decision for them in an ironic twist of what happened last time. Where Hunter was insisting that they stay and everyone else was, no, we've got to be practical, we've got to go. Because Omega, we're not going to rescue her by staying here. We have to go to escape who we're being chased by. Again, they have to escape the Imperials. But one of their own has been left behind. Except instead of Omega being kidnapped this time, Hunter is left behind. Because there are an overwhelming amount of Imperial forces physically stopping them from rescuing him. So, Tech... Like, Hunter insists that they go. Omega's screaming and wailing not to let him go. But the others understand that from a practical point of view, they have to go. Because they're being swarmed by Imperial vessels. So Hunter falls all the way down the mountain. He doesn't die. I thought Hunter was going to die when I watched this. I thought Hunter was dead. And I was like, no, they would not. Because everyone's saying someone had to die by the end of the season. Well, that didn't happen. And reluctantly, they jump to hyperspace. They leave Hunter behind, where he gets surrounded by tons of TK troopers, these kind of like dog things, and a bunch of commandos, including Scorch. And it is just so bizarre to me that Scorch is in this episode. He was the happy-go-lucky guy from Republic Commando. He was the funny one. And seeing him working for the Empire, silent but deadly like this, is kind of scary. And it still makes you wonder what happened to the others. Also, hello, Diamond Chef. Thank you. I'm glad you like my hair. I'm glad you think it's good. Hey, I just joined, but are you aware your stream can't see the footage from the episode? Yes, Lucy. I'm really sorry, but that's Disney. It's actually a good thing because it's stopping me from getting copyright. You can't see the footage because Disney Plus has this, like, copyright filter. It's really neat. Also, is my stream lagging? I'm seeing drop frames. No one mentioned anything. But yeah, no, you can see this, but no, it's fine. You can't see us. I'm just being an idiot. But anyway, Lucy, I should probably mention, I'm talking about spoilers for Bad Batch. If you're ever interested, don't watch this. You're probably not, but I'm talking big spoilers. So I'm about to talk about the season finale. We're coming to the end of the stream now, guys. And also, Lucy, I'm aware we're doing sister locations soon. I'm going to put a message on there now, guys. Sorry, guys. We might be delayed a few minutes because this stream's been longer than I thought it would be. I'm really sorry. But yeah, Alright, Lucy, fair enough. That, you probably will have, actually. I've been in your position, and yeah. But, But yeah, I'm sorry. I am being a dumbass, like, doing this. I should just be on this camera when I'm not looking at the tier list. So, the episode ends. Hunter is captured by the Empire. We see another scene of... yeah, this is the scene where Lamasu gets executed. And then Crosshair turns up. Hunter's an Imperial Sayer. Guess who turns up? It's Crosshair. And he's like, I was hoping for the whole squad, but you'll do. And it's like, here we go. The War-Mantle's kind of like a third part of the finale, I would consider. So yeah, so Crosshair turns up, that's the finale, and then we've got Return to Kamino. Hunter told Omega, you wouldn't go back to Kamino, but here we are. And by the way, War-Mantle, guys, is absolutely an S rank. I love this episode. Character development, we get that for Echo. We get the introduction of Gregor, which really begs the question, where is Wolf? Because Gregor, Wolf, and Rex with the three clones we saw in Rebels. Is Rex on a mission to get Wolf now? Is that why he didn't turn up? Is he busy trying to get Wolf and maybe a few other clones? What about Hauser, you know? And, you know... War-Mantle also, you know, introduces us to some great world building with the TK Troopers and the Commandos. We get a Republic Commando reference again. And again, high stakes. It did exactly what Reunion did, but in a way that was like a clever twist, kind of like Portal 2, rather than like a repetitive thing. Alright, Lucy. That's okay, Lucy. It's fine. It's fine. We'll work that out, okay? I know we're doing a stream together in 20 minutes. I think it's going to start maybe just 10, 15 minutes later, okay? It'll be fine, all right? Just don't panic. This has happened before. We'll manage. I'm just going to finish my review now, guys, all right? Tier list. So, the finale, Return to Kamino. You start off with Crosshair activating Hunter's comlink so that the Bad Batch tracks them because he's luring them into a trap. They know it's a trap, but they still go for it. And interestingly, they drop off Gregor with Sid. So that's kind of a neat way of writing Gregor out of the plot of this, even though we just had him. So, like, there's a place for him to go. That's why Sid's been there the whole time as well. So, like, you can imagine how those interactions would go. But, yeah, Hunter's captured. He faces Rampart. Kamino is being cleared out. And we actually get the music from Attack of the Clones. Big callback with the Kamino theme. It's so cool. It's so cool. We see one of the, you know, elite squadron, like, you know, human soldiers being suspicious of Crosshair and his intentions. So, like, you know, there's already a lot of shady behind the back kind of stuff. Omega, interestingly, the Bad Batch sneak back on Kamino via a secret route with Omega's help, and you think, okay, Crosshair's gone, Hunter's gone, who takes charge? Not Horeka, not Tech, not even Echo. Omega's actually the one who really takes charge. And it's revealed that she's not just a clone, she's actually their older sister. She saw the place where they were born. The laboratory where they were born is where she was also born. They were special experienced by Nala Se. And it's like, there's this great lore, which builds a character and kind of adds context, like, wow, so she's actually their older sister. Even though she's like a kid who looks 13, and they're like 20, even though they're actually like 5, because they've been like accelerated aging. It's weird, but I love it. And, you know, you've got some exposition, some real, finally, something that's been missing for up until this point, I really felt it was like a real deep dialogue, character dynamic between Hunter and Crosshair, because in Reunion, it was kind of like hitting a blank wall because that inhibitor chip was going off. You know, they didn't really get a face-to-face in, you know, Rescue on Ryloth, and they haven't, you know, before that, you know, we already had Aftermath. So, like, we finally get the confrontation. And we get the plot twist, the reveal that Crosshair actually had his inhibitor chip removed a long time ago. A bigger plot twist than I am your father to some. The Bad Batch goes to rescue Hunter. It's obviously a trap. Crosshair has a whole thing set up in the training room where they were back in the first episode. You know, they're surrounded. They drop their weapons. And yeah, plot twist, Crosshair actually wants them to join the Empire. He doesn't want to kill them because he still loves them as brothers. And he kills the other Imperial agents to prove so. Meanwhile, Omega's staying behind the scenes with AZ. Again, another great element of this was the return of AZ from Season 6. The same droid that helped Fives. I was hoping for a connection. It didn't happen, but, you know, he was mind-wiped. Not destroyed, of course. But yeah, it's a really cool sequence. Really strong character moment for Crosshair. Like, we finally get, like, you know, not only an amazing plot twist, but, like, some real in-depth, like, you know, motive for Crosshair. He's not just like the others obeying orders because of the mind control. He's doing this of his own free will. He genuinely believes in the doctrine of the Empire. He genuinely believes in, you know, order And at all costs, and you know, he, you know, doesn't feel remorse for the war crimes he's committed, although he does feel remorse for being left behind, left for dead by his brothers, who never once tried to come back for him. And you can almost not sympathize, but empathize with Crosshair, despite being the bad guy and doing terrible things. He, you know, he's not wrong. You know, the Bad Batch didn't try and rescue him at any point. They didn't feel like they could. And Tech notices the little, like, reflection-like things for those lasers that he used in Season 7. And then he uses one shot to kill all the Imperial troops. He tries to get them to join his side. Omega releases the training droids when she tried to help them, but that turned out to be a mistake. So Crosshair ends up fighting side by side with the Batch against the training droids in a bit of a symbolic moment. It's a bit dumb, but it's kind of an excuse to have a fight happen. And then one of the Imperial, like, the TKs notices, and she leaves, and she's like, you know, Cross has lost control, so they leave. And it's not clear if she's aware that Cross has betrayed them, from their view, or if he's just lost control. But then we get Tarkin back. At the end of the episode, we get Tarkin back on the comm, you know, talking to Rampa, and he says the iconic line, "You may fire when ready." And it's revealed that the reason Kamino's been completely cleared out is because it's being destroyed. The Tipoca City, the facility, it has an orbital bombardment. They absolutely decimate the city, and it leaves on a cliffhanger. Return to Kamino is one of the strongest episodes. It's a fantastic finale. It honestly feels like that should have been the last episode, and that should have been the cliffhanger for Season 2 to pick up, because the next episode feels like an epilogue or like a start of Season 2 rather than a finale. Again, I guess there's probably maybe a few things they missed, but the Crosshair character development is really strong. The plot development is awesome. The stakes are high. This to me is definitely an A rank. Maybe even an S rank. I'm not sure. I'm gonna give it an S rank. All that leaves is Kamino lost. In the finale, it's kind of weird. The Vast One felt like a finale, but then at the start of Part 2, the Empire leaves. They just go. It's like, boom, the threat's gone. Tipoca City's just imploding, it's collapsing, like, the whole place has been utterly destroyed, and the entire episode is just the Bad Batch trying to escape. Just going through the halls, having dialogue, having near-death encounters, and it's a weird way to do a finale. I feel like it should have been sold as an epilogue rather than a finale part two, because the stakes are low again. Well, kind of. It doesn't feel like a high, exciting, action-filled finale. It's just kind of like a character moment. So basically, they have to work together to escape, but Crosshair is just in disgusted, because he's like, "I can't believe you guys leave the Empire and leave me, and like, you're all traitors." And Hunter's just like, "You know what? You want to die here alone, or you want to live? You come with us, or you can die." So he reluctantly goes with them. And yeah, Crosshair's just kind of pissed. He's just constantly pissed. Crosshair has not smiled since Season 7. He's just one of the most angry characters. Lucy, this isn't a spoiler, but someone did a comparison, which I sent you a screenshot of one time, of him and, shit, what's his name? The Firebender in Avatar. Prince... Not Azula. Zuko! That was it. Yeah, Zuko. Yeah. They've also both got scars. Yeah, Zuko. That was it. Yeah. Crosshair has been compared to Zuko, which is really interesting, because I never would have thought of it. But, if Crosshair gets a redemption arc, you know, we could be looking at a similar situation here. So, yeah. There's just a load of great character moments. It's a bit disappointing first time watching, but when you think about it and review it, first of all, we get AZ actually serving a good purpose to the plot and helping them escape with his, you know, ability. I thought AZ was gonna die. It looked like AZ was gonna die. And it looked like Omega was gonna die. But then Crosshair actually saves them. He saved their lives. And, you know, he pulls out his gun to get like a net to like launch them. And he turns around and everyone else has got their guns pointed at them because they don't trust him. The bond has been broken. And it's making everyone really begin to question, how much did their brothership really mean in the first place? All they were before the end of the Clone War was a bunch of organic droids made to fight and work together. How much did they really mean to each other? And like, why was it so easy for them to be split apart like this? And yeah, it's scary to think about the consequences of that. And yeah, they pretty much just escape. There's just, I don't know, it's just decent character building, just rounding off the season. Really, there's not much plot-wise, like, at all. It ends on the platform. For the first time in Star Wars history, we have seen Kamino sunny. There is no rain. This is the first time in canon we've ever seen Kamino when it's not raining. The entire place is smoking, destroyed. That's why the title's Kamino Lost. Tipoca City's gone. And we see all seven members. AZ's deactivated at this point. But Wrecker's carrying him, so you've got Tech, Wrecker, Echo, Omega, Hunter, and Crosshair, all six of them together, all six bad batches, as I would like to think, maybe seven, eight if you include Gonki, who saved the day in War-Mantle, I forgot to mention. And they're just kind of looking like their home, it's gone. And you can just see the remorse really in their eyes, especially Echo, because Echo fought, you know, tooth and claw to protect this place all the way back in, you know, Clone Wars Season 3. And that's where, with Fives, he became an ARC trooper, and like, that's, he's got a lot, it's a lot of significance for him especially. And I'm glad they made his facial expression a bit more remorseful to really show that, but they all feel saddened, because this is the only thing they had, which they could really call a home. Even Crosshair, I mean, he's always pouting, but like, yeah, it's gone, and Omega's kind of front and center here. She's really, I think, the protagonist of the series, in a way. So the Bad Batch have their ship, where it was parked when they first came in, they're ready to leave, they rescued Hunter, and they give Crosshair the offer to join them. And it's like, well, join us. You can come with us, Crosshair. And everyone was thinking, someone's gonna die. Hunter's gotta die at the end of the season. Crosshair's gotta die. No, they're gonna spin this out a few seasons, okay? The series just ends. Like, Crosshair's just like, no. I'm not joining you. And then Hunter says, just because we want different things doesn't mean we have to be enemies. EC Tech is the first to head off because he has no emotion. He's just like completely logical and rational. So they just kind of quietly leave, leaving Crosshair on the platform sitting. Omega's the last one to talk to him because, you know, she has a lot of empathy and a lot of, you know, insightfulness and a lot more emotional intelligence than the others. You know, she's a girl and also she's a child. And she just tries to talk to Crosshair, you know, telling him, you know, you're my brother. And it's a really sad moment, like, you know, not a dry eye in the house. I'm tearing up thinking about it. Because Crosshair's so bitter, but, like, deep down, he really does love these guys, you know, as family. Because that is what they are, and they're nothing stronger than family at the end of the day. So that's that. They just leave Crosshair behind because he won't come with them. He refuses to budge. And presumably, he is picked up by Imperial scouts later on, which is mentioned. But the thing is, are the Empire gonna, like, take him in because they think he's betrayed them, right? And there's this fantastic panning shot. And that's basically the end of the season. We get one final scene where we see Nala Se, the Kaminoan scientist, meet another Kaminoan scientist who has, like, goggles similar to Tech, taken by Imperial commandos with, like, 501st painting, which is really interesting. They got some kind of, like, blue-gray paint. I don't know what that is. It's probably not 501st, but it's, like, they meet with a bunch of commandos back on the secret, like, War-Mantle planet, and they're gonna need her for some kind of experiment, which we don't know. It might be, I hope they don't connect it to reviving Palpatine in the sequels, because that kind of sucked, and they do something maybe more with the Mandalorian, with, like, you know, trying to get Force-sensitive clones, maybe, with, like, you know, like they did with, like, Grogu's blood. But, you know, the series just ends there. That's pretty much it. And there is a teaser for season two, so on my tier list, that last episode, I think to rate it low would be to misunderstand its function. It's not supposed to be a bombastic finale like Return to Kamino. It's supposed to be an epilogue and a kind of setup of the next season. I'm going to give it an A. I think there maybe could have been a bit more with the character to make up for the lack of plot, but I'm going to give it an A. And that, my friends, is my Bad Batch tier list. This is just season one. This is going to be, not that, this is going to be Mr. Matt's Bad Batch tier list. This isn't actually a tier list I made, so we don't need to repeat that. This is my Bad Batch tier list. Season 1 episode ranking. I'm just gonna save this. So guys, if you have enjoyed, leave a like, subscribe if you haven't already. Shit, that's soon. If you haven't already, like, share, subscribe, I really appreciate it. Check out the links in the description below, check out the Trussell Trust, check out, you know, the tier list, and share your own if you want on the Hydration Nation. The Discord link is also in the description and on my banner. This is my review and tier list of The Bad Batch. Really strong show, had a few weak episodes, but I think most of it was really good. Great character development, great plot development. I love the direction it's gone in. It's a great way of kind of tying Clone Wars with Rebels and the kind of episode 3, episode 4 gap in the wider Star Wars kind of anthology. But even if you're not a hardcore fanboy who doesn't care about the lore, it just tells a good story and it introduces some really strong characters. And I'm just happy to be here. So that's my tier list. I'm downloading that, and that is the end of the stream. Now, this stream's gone on longer than I thought it would be. This doesn't happen often, but I've poorly planned, so I'm gonna delay sister location by 20 minutes. Sorry, fellas. I'll write a message on there properly, but I'm gonna be getting started on that. So Lucy, don't panic. We'll get on that. I'll be with you in a moment. No one had a go at the QOTD, so I guess no one here has watched Bad Batch. But hey, maybe this has introduced you to the show. Guys, if you want to see more Star Wars content, because that is something I'm doing, check out Republic Commando. I've done other debate directs. Watch Clone Wars. Watch the animated Clone Wars TV show and Bad Batch. They're really, really good. I know Rebels doesn't look great, but give it a chance. It's got some decent episodes later on. I mean, it depends how much you care about spoilers as well. But yeah, thank you for joining, Dario. Sorry I didn't see you. Chat's been pretty dead. But yeah, that's all. I am just having a blast. This has been really cool. Bad Batch is such a good TV show. I'm really excited for season 2. It is one of the things I'm most hyped for, as well as Book of Boba Fett, Ahsoka, Obi-Wan, and Mando Season 3. There's loads of good stuff coming to Star Wars, so yeah. Thank you, Dave Filoni. Thank you, what's his name? Oh, what was the name of the director of Mando? I've forgotten his name. Thank you, everybody who's worked on the show. Everyone. The animators. The soundtrack, Kevin Kiner. You know, the directors. And you know what? Thank you, George Lucas. You made something really special, dude. Yeah, that's all for today, guys. All right, I will see you around soon. I've got another stream to do, so thank you for watching and stay hydrated.